My name is Mahdi Omar. This is the African Television Network of New England. Roland Fomundam was born and raised in Cameroon. He moved to the United States in 2003 and started his education at Bristol Community College, Fall River, Massachusetts. He graduated from there with honors with an Associate Liberal Arts, Maths and Science, and also received the most prestigious award for any student of color, which is the Student of Color Achievement Award bestowed by the governor of Massachusetts. His award and achievement gave him an opportunity to study at Northeastern University, where he earned a dual degree in business administration and biology, and then a Master of Science in Technology Entrepreneurship. Roland is an acclaimed social entrepreneur and has proven this in his numerous activities in the social enterprise sector. Currently, he is the founder and executive director of Use Action Africa nonprofit organization, and he is also co-founder of Lebolo Inc., a job search portal exclusively for Cameroonian, and founder and principal consultant at Kuza Holding in Cameroon. He is affiliated to numerous professional organizations, which include the National Colgate Inventor and Innovative Alliance, the World Entrepreneurship Forum, and the Information for Development Forum by the World Bank. Welcome to our studio, Mr. Roland.
Thank you, Mr. Mahdi. Thanks for having me again.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Truly busy young man. You have met the great governor of our state. And what is the Student of Color Achievement Award, by the way?
Well, the Student of Color Achievement Award, it's the highest award bestowed to a student of color at Bristol Community College. And I had the privilege to earn that degree, that award, based on my achievements while I was at Bristol Community College. First of all, I started at Bristol Community College in 2004, and I was one of the only students that actually received an associate's in a year, because I doubled a lot of my classes. I think towards the end of my term at Bristol Community College, I was the only student that took nine classes at that time.
Nine courses,
wow. Correct. And I was a lab assistant for two labs. I was a tutor for four different subjects, which was biology, mathematics, chemistry, and French. And I started the first science club at Bristol Community College. It is a school that has been existing for 40 years, and no one had ever started something like that. So I started that initiative, which was meant to connect high schools in that area through Bristol Community College. And the main goal was promoting science awareness in those areas. So based on all those things, I think I earned that degree. And I think the award day, I was one of the only students that received in total of eight different awards. So. I think I really deserved it, and I was happy that I did get that recognition by His Excellency, the Governor of Massachusetts.
Yeah, congratulations. I mean,
thank you.
But did it come with cash?
Well, well, the cash wasn't there, but the cash was in kind, you know, because I think that particular achievement actually paved the way for me for other achievements that I did receive thereafter. Mm-hmm. For example, I had a scholarship to study at Northeastern University, and I mean, it was just a rolling ball of ice because different things just started happening thereafter, and that also gave me the confidence to pursue my goals in terms of, well, I knew that what I was doing, people were watching, and I just had to keep doing them and making sure that I'm good at whatever I was doing. And so, you know, no matter how small it was, no matter what I was trying to do, I just had in the back of my mind that, you know, someday, somehow, someone is watching, and no matter how long it might take, I would definitely be recognized for the few things that I've been engaged in. And so, yeah, you know, that award, even though it wasn't a cash at that time, but, you know, it is slowly converting into cash now. I can say that.
See, African television recognized you for your excellence, my friend. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Really, you're really a role model for a young African who live in Massachusetts. So congratulations is in order.
Thanks again.
Yeah, but currently you are running as an executive director the African Use Action Africa. Tell us a little bit about that organization.
Well, Youth Action Africa, it's a young youth-led organization with a mission to alleviate poverty and improve health conditions in Africa through education, access to information and resources. What we do, it is a global network of youths joining efforts to promote technological advancements in Africa by initiating education initiatives that target specific areas of interest in creating projects that are sustainable, that are scalable, and whose success is tangible and visible.
Yeah, but initially, this organization was formed to fight malaria in Cameroon. What made you decide to change from that initial goal of this organization to that of the current goal of Youth Action Africa?
Well, interesting question, Omar. Well, Youth Action Africa, I'm glad you really brought up this particular question because Youth Action Africa has seen different phases or two before it is what it is. Initially, when I started this initiatives, it started as a class project. And then building on the class project, I thought, well, what I've been writing about, what I've been researching, I could actually think of doing it. Because from my class presentations, I realized there was so much interest in the topics that I did share. And so my first goal was, how do we prevent something like malaria, which has been in existence for hundreds and hundreds of years? Something that a lot of money has been invested in. And it is one of the easiest preventable diseases, but yet people still die of it. And most of the victims are those that live in developing nations, and you would, you know, call Africa as, you know, its main victim. So my goal at that time was, how do we provide these preventives? And I was lucky, I had some donations for mosquito treated nets, which I took to Cameroon that year, which was in 2006, for donations. I was in Cameroon for 3 weeks after giving these nets out to the locality where I live there. I had feedback, and the feedback I had was a mixed feedback. It was good and it was bad. I will start with the bad one. The bad was the fact that the people that I gave them these nets didn't use them. They sold them.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was kind of disheartening, considering the fact that I worked so hard to get these things there. I, you know, spent my own money just to get these nets there, and you know, thought I was doing something really, really good for the people, for my people. But then, they sold them.
Yeah.
But you know, being who I am, and in my mindset, and my whole entrepreneurial, you know, focus, I didn't take that as any. I sent it downfall. I took that as a challenge. And to me, challenges are always opportunities. because I wanted to find out what exactly, why exactly did these people sell these nets? Because to me, looking at it, I believe that they need them. But to them, they didn't need those nets. So when talking back with these people, good enough, which is a good side of it, they were very honest to me. They told me, hey, Roland, thank you for your nets, but I was hungry.
Yeah.
And I needed money to eat. So they would sell them, and which is very normal. Mm-hmm. And now, in my own sense, I went back and started looking at it. I said, well, this is quite interesting. Because here am I, Cameroonian, thinking I want to give back to my own people, but they don't get what I'm trying to give it to them. And you know, I needed to find out what was the sole purpose. And you then go on to realize, well, these are people that have lived for a very long time with no mosquito-treated nets. So it's very normal for them to think that, well, you're giving them nets at that time, maybe it's not what they really need, you know. And also, I mean, nets, you only under those nets at night, so what happens during the day? So, and then, you know, you have people that will say, well, we don't even believe these nets work. I mean, I'm hungry, I might die without even sleeping under this net, so maybe I'd get something which is better. So what all of this did to me was, it made me rethink my whole strategy. I should go for what the people need, not what they want. Because from here, I just read the books, I did the research, and I thought, this is what they want. But there was something underlying to it, which was what they needed. And which was what now gave birth to Youth Action Africa. When I came back to the US, I still on this very notion again, soul searching, trying to find out what could happen. As a matter of fact, I took a second trip to Cameroon. And the second trip this time was, I was lucky, I had a donation of condoms, which I took to Cameroon and gave out to the people. And the same thing happened, they sold them.
Yeah.
You know, and I said, well, what, I mean, I was almost giving up, you know, but, you know. What is going on, you know? I thought, well, this is me, and I'm a young student, I'm using my own student loans just to make things happen for my own people, and it's like they don't appreciate it.
Yeah.
And so when I came back, I said, well, on this quest, I'm already halfway through, I just need to find out what is the underlying solution.
Sure.
And in South Africa, when I visited there in the summer of 2008, I happened to be there when they had xenophobia, which was when they had black South Africans killing other black Africans, calling them foreigners, kicking them out of the country.
Yeah.
So I visited one of the refugee camps, and I met with one young lady from Zimbabwe. And trying to ask her, I told her, I represent this organization from the US, and I'm here to find out what exactly we could do for you. Mm. She turned around, and in a very calm voice, she said, we need just one thing. And I was waiting to hear. I thought she would say money, clothes, shoes. She said, just give us education.
Yeah.
Education is all we need. If we have education, then we would be able to carry on with our own lives. We would know what we don't know.
Yeah.
And when I came back to the US, I said, well, how could we find a way to provide access to information, because education is access to information.
Yeah.
And once you have access to this information, then you have access to resources. And that was how this whole Youth Action Africa started. So as a matter of fact, before I left South Africa, we were able to piece up some resources, and we started a small computer literacy program with just 10 computers and 6 participants, which I used as my pilot project. And the success of that was really huge, because it gave me the courage and the encouragement to move on with that particular concept, which was providing a computer learning center wherein you could embed other programs in it. And that was the birth of Youth Action Africa.
Yeah. Have you gotten any substantial funding from a different organization to help you run this organization?
Well, no, not as yet.
Yeah.
Not as yet. And I mean, one of it is, it could be based on the fact that we haven't actively searched.
Mm.
And it was also because I was really trying to see how I best define this program, how I could mold it, and how I could replicate the program, because being here and getting involved in Africa, it is kind of challenging. I needed to find a way that I could have a program in these areas and could monitor this program, evaluate them for success. But now I think we are ready for any amount of funds that we could get, because to tell you, we already have two centers in Africa right now. There is another center in Ghana and another one in Cameroon. And we are actively searching for funds, funding opportunities, and other resources such as computers as well at this point.
Yeah, as you can say, it is very difficult to lead life in America to begin with. And you have to go to school, you have to work. Beside that, running a non-profit organization without a budget in and of itself is a very, very challenging thing. So I'm hoping that some, like Bill Gates Foundation, things of that kind of organization would be able to help you so that you can run this organization even better way. But there are so many non-profit organizations in Cameroon, in all over Africa, millions. What is unique about your organization?
Well, I think the uniqueness of Youth Action Africa starts with who we are. I believe that the future of Africa lies in the youth. And not only Africa, I think the future of the world today lies in the youths that are now, because the future, we represent the future. And the others that are coming, you know, after us, we have to act as mentors to them. So if we believe that we want to have a world tomorrow that would be good for us, then we need to make a pathway which others could learn from it. And that is what Youth Action Africa brings to the table. So because the problems today are our problems, and the youths are in that position to really pinpoint these problems and create solutions for these particular problems. And the solutions are solutions that we know that could last in our lifetime. And that is what Youth Action Africa brings. And the thing about Youth Action Africa is the fact that we are not only focused on one particular solution. We look for that solution that caters for multiple problems. So creating a platform wherein other problems could be solved on that particular platform. So for example, we have our flagship project is a computer learning platform. We have others, another project that deals in agriculture. We have another one which is more like a social service a project. The interesting thing also is, how do we come up with our projects? Our premise is, we start with asking the question, why? Why is Africa or Africans the way it is today? And then moving on from why, we ask, what is it that it is the problem? And then after identifying the problem, we find out who is it that we could impact? Who is it that we could go to? Or who it is that we could empower to be a catalyst of this particular solution? And then the last is, what is the solution? You know, what do we bring to the table? So having all these things, you know, it makes it possible for us to create solutions that tie in the cultural context of every region. Because Africa is a very big continent.
Very huge.
54 countries, a billion population. We have so many tribes, fragmented, people will say them. So we try to find solutions that are specific for every region. What might work in Cameroon might not work in Somalia. What might work in Somalia might not work in Ethiopia, neither in Senegal. So we make sure that, okay, our platform, we bring in people from all these regions who know these places, who can give us access to these places, and then for us to study the area with the people on the ground and then create a solution that involves the people, not only us living from here and saying that, well, we've read, we've seen in the TV that, okay, this solution is what you need, and go on there and saying that, well, we think that this is good for you. No, we get the people involved in the solution process. And then the interesting thing is, whatever solutions that we create, we let the people on the ground run the projects so that they see the success of it. It is something that benefits them and your own communities. so they have that time to really be involved in it wholeheartedly. So I think that is what makes Youth Action Africa very, very unique. And we have no motive for making ourselves better. We believe that for us to be better, others need to be better. And we define success by how many people we could empower, how many people could create solutions based on what we have introduced. And that is what we define as success. And how can we replicate the different projects that we have in one particular region to another region? Because, I mean, for example, Nigeria and Cameroon, they are neighboring countries. If you think that you can cure all problems in Cameroon when Nigeria still has the same problems, then you would find out that people from Nigeria leave into Cameroon. Mm-hmm. And then that cycle of problems continues. Mm-hmm. So there is that neighbor effect wherein if you don't solve the problems across these boundaries, you would have people coming in and the mm-hmm. same problems continues. And that is one reason why the problems that are existing today keep on existing no matter how much aid or impact has gone into these areas. So we try to make sure that we have something to do in every of these regions so that we target problems that are specific for these regions as a means to solve a continental problem.
Beautiful. How do the African governments, when you, for instance, open an office in Ghana or Cameroon capital city, Luanda, the African governments are helpful to you? Do they recognize you as a non-profit organization, or do they try to close you? How do they cooperate with you?
Well, I think that is an interesting point, because you would normally listen to it, and the fact that we are a non-profit organization, we are youth-led, we would want to assume that the government would definitely favor you. Normally, my experience, we haven't had any issues in particular with governments, besides in Egypt, where for the longest time we tried having a branch in Egypt, but the bureaucracy in the area just couldn't let us do it. And you would not say it is the government in general, which you might think is the president. No, it is maybe just all the members that hold different offices.
The corrupt
officials. Yeah, you know, it is sometimes it's just hard to get a document from one table to the other. You know, the people themselves are not willing to do certain things. So it makes the work kind of very tedious.
Yeah.
So what we have adapted to do is looking for organizations that are already based in these areas, because those are the people that know, you know, how they could play things in these regions. So we identify organizations that are already in these areas, and then we seek to work with them in terms of improving their productivity. And we believe that their success is our success.
True.
So that is one way we've really had to get around with the bureaucracy, because if I had to leave from here and say, well, I want to go register a branch in Ghana or in Cameroon, I would have to be there, first of all.
Yeah.
And would not only be there for a day or two or a week, I would have to be there longer than that.
Sure.
And that still doesn't guarantee that it would be over.
Mm-hmm.
So working with grassroots organizations on the ground, it is the key to our success in getting into the different areas in Africa.
Yeah, but when you send books, for instance, computer to this organization, having that non-profit organization give you or allow you to pass through custom without being charged, you don't have money to begin with. You literally beg this computer from the American people to send it back home. And the government, at least they can do is to let you go without paying the custom. So that's what I'm saying. No, if the government knows who you are and what you are doing, at least you can send the book to these people, to African community, and they can pass through custom without paying hard-earned pennies, you know. So I think it's very important, although I understand the corruption, the bureaucracy in Africa, but at the same time, having had that recognition from the government would allow you to send a lot of things that are irrelevant here, but very important and useful in Africa to send it back home without any difficulties. Don't you think so?
No, that's so true. And that is kind of the sad part about it, because when we go, well, you have all proper documentations as a nonprofit organization, we recognize here and this and that. Well, under the books of most of these countries, for example, in Cameroon, normally computers are supposed to get in there for free. But whoever you have to speak with, just the fact that you are coming from the United States, well, they don't look at you. They see, when they look at you, all they see is the dollar sign. So, well,
even though you begged,
you know, even though they would say, well, just even, you know, something just to get them by, you know. But sometimes you just have to play the game, because someone like me, I'm always focused on the price. You know that that is a system, because in the position in which they are, we tend to understand why they are there, how they are there. And you know, if sometimes if it means, you know, just losing maybe $100 or two or three or some amount that you think you can afford to lose, then just do it and then just move on, because I think we are more focused with the people on the ground. And also, I believe that since we are still young and new, these people still haven't known exactly what we really mean to do. And once we can get to that large scale where we have a huge impact in the economic development and the socioeconomic lives of the people, I believe that we would have that recognition that is needed even at the level of the ports, where we will be able to get in things, you know, for the rate that we really need to get them. So it is a problem that I believe that we have a formula to deal with it.
Yeah. And how old is the your organization?
Well, my organization is 4 years now.
Yeah. Yep. It's getting there.
It's getting there, slowly, surely.
We have only 5 minutes left. So definitely when we come back, I will have more questions. But you studied a dual degree in biology and business administration, and of course a master in entrepreneurship. The combination is amazing, you know, biology, business, entrepreneurship. It's amazing combination. Why? Why didn't you study, say, government and political science, for instance? What attracted you to this particular profession?
Well, I think those professions, that discipline, it is key to every economy right now, because the biology gives you that research ability. You're able to analyze things, and the business part of it gives you that ability where you could recognize opportunities and resources and being able to connect them. And technology entrepreneurship definitely brings in the technology part of it, wherein, because I mean right now everything runs on technology, and we believe that, okay, if you really want to succeed in doing a lot of these things, then find a way that, you know, you could use your analytical knowledge, use your business knowledge of being able to identify resources, and then put all of them on a technology platform so they could run. And I think that was my thinking at that time. And also because I am someone that when I started, as a matter of fact, I wanted to be a medical doctor. But then at one time I thought, well, maybe I should go and be a lawyer, you know. And then I said, well, maybe I wanted to be an engineer, you know. And I said, well, instead of trying to be all of this, what can I be that could have all these people around me? And I just thought, well, being an entrepreneur would just be the perfect fit, where, okay, if you're an entrepreneur, you would definitely have a lawyer around you, you would definitely have a doctor, you would definitely have an engineer, you would have a social scientist. And I think that is my thinking, and that is what drove me into all these fields.
Yeah. Can this discipline translate it into Youth Action Africa?
Oh yeah. Big time, because without such a discipline, then the mindset on which I am right now, the things that we are doing, we have done, and what we hope to do, could not really be achieved, because I'm the founder of the organization. I have members that I do lead, so you definitely need that visionary person who stands atop of it to kind of pave the way for the organization to succeed and being able to implement its projects in target areas. So I think, yeah, it's very, very needed.
Yeah, you can use it both in terms of individual lifestyle, the profession, and at the same time, you can use that discipline to run non-profit organization. We don't have too much time. Definitely, when we come back, I will have more questions for you. You are watching the African Television Network of New England. We will be right back.
اسمع ونظرة نظرة تغير حالي نظرة تغير حالي
لا عايزين تتحل لا عايزين تتحل لا لا عايزين تتحل ولا تفهم حالي ليه انت ما عطف عليها حياتي حبيبي انت حياتي انت انت حياتي وهنا ونصيبي
حبيتك ليه جمالك بحبك تعذيبي حبيتك ليه جمالك بحبك تعذيبي
حبيتك من بسمة حبيتك من نظرة حبيتك من بسمة في كمالي
يا عايش في خيالي
لا عايزين تتحن لا عايزين تتحن لا 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 عايزين تتحن ولا ترحم حالي ليه انت ما تعطف عليا
اسمع وزرع
My guest today is here in our studio is a young Cameroonian, Mr. Roland Fomundam, and he is a founder of Youth Action Africa. Welcome back again. Before the break, we were talking about your dual degree in biology and business, and at the same time, entrepreneurship, how that can be used for both individual life, at the same time, the African Youth Action Africa. That was a very good answer. But my next question for you will be, as an African, what can I do to help your organization? What do you want from me?
Well, I mean, Omar, I mean, being in your position, I believe that you stand in a place where you could definitely help Youth Action Africa, you know, get the recognition that we do deserve, especially in terms of publicity. I think being here today, if there's anything that I'm hoping to achieve, it's being able to reach out to the African community, and not only the African community, but anyone in the world today, because you don't have to be an African, to work in Africa or to work for Africa. Why? Because what affects Africa affects America. We've seen it, crisis in Libya, giving us high gas prices in the U.S. So, and there's so many things that relate to things like this. So I believe that Youth Action Africa stands at a point where we are in need of talent. And talent doesn't mean that you have to come in with something already, but we have a platform where we have people who have different disciplines. And the people that we have been able to have, or that we do have right now, have the mindset where we believe in sharing. We believe that for us to succeed, we should be able to motivate others, inspire others, so that we could collectively do something that is huge, not only for ourselves, but also for the continent. And one thing that I always talk about myself is the fact that I want to have huge investments at some point in Africa. But the problem is, why would you want to have investments when there is no buy-in market? And when I mean by buy-in market would be, if I have something, maybe a business in Africa today, and Africans don't buy my product, then I am not in business. The African population is 1 billion, which presents a huge market. I mean, population is bigger than what we have in the United States. And I believe that for you to really think of succeeding in that environment is creating something that the people themselves can buy. But if you think that what you're trying to create, the people cannot buy it, why don't you find a way to enable these people to become buyers? And to do so is being able to provide them with resources or opportunities for them to recognize the resources around them to use, so they could improve on their own socioeconomic lives. And by so doing, you empower them to become financially feasible, so that they could now have that purchasing power to buy things that they do need. Mm-hmm. So that is where I'm driving to.
Yeah, but what can I do to help you, or our viewers, our young African who watch this television program, if they want to join? What do you really want from this young African student here?
I mean, I think I need as much as, you know, many people to get involved with what we are doing, assisting in terms of fundraising, outreach, so that we could, you know, be able to get resources and especially funding that is needed. For 4 years that this organization has been running, I have been, you know, using my own funds for it. Mm. Not as if I have, but, you know, lucky that I'm in the U.S. and I could have some student loans. So I have used, you know, most part of my student loans
to help us,
you know, for this organization. And I think now is the time where we should be able to get funding from members of the public or other people that are interested in helping out in these regions, directly or indirectly. So if I would ask you anything directly, it is being is for you to help in helping us in the outreach side of this particular organization, and also for us to reach out to the masses of youths around here and around the world to be part of us. And they could be part of us indirectly and directly. And indirectly, I mean that by doing something similar to what we are doing. And directly, it is coming to what we already have. If you think that, well, you could create something better than what we have, then go ahead and do so. We believe that success here, success there, is collective success for all of us.
Sure.
And we would strongly encourage things like that. So it's only getting out to the youths so that they could start thinking creatively and think of also doing things like what we are doing.
Excellent, excellent. You know, what is amazing to me, you're a young man, and you have 3 degrees from a very prominent institution, which is Northeastern University. The easiest thing for you to do would have been go out and have a nice car and have fun and be jolly in this country. But you have chosen a very honorable, respectable give back to your community. That is very, very admirable in my view. But who has been a key in inspiration in your life?
I think that definitely goes to my mother. She has been the pillar for everything that I am today. To tell you the truth, my mom, my dad passed away when I was months old, oh, you know, 9 months old. And my mom at that time, she was 22 years old. Mm-hmm. And we are 4 of us and all boys. And up to now, I still ask her every day, how were you able to raise all of us?
Yeah.
You know, in Cameroon at the age of 22 when you had no job. Mm. So.
As a woman.
As a woman.
Yeah.
As a woman. I mean, I think that really it's key in it because being who she was, she just came out of school and she had no job. But after her dad passed away, she had to find something to do. But, you know, all in all, she gave us the best education. We never went a day without food. We never felt shy amongst the crowd in terms of maybe we didn't look as good as the others.
Mm-hmm.
So she did everything for us. And I think the simplest thing or the smallest thing that I could do, it is, you know, to make her proud. And if there is anything that she tells me every day, it is keep working hard, be good to others, and do good. Put others first because they would put you first too.
Yeah.
And that is what I'm doing. And I'm not only doing it for her, I'm doing it for others.
Sure.
Because she said, put others first.
Yeah.
And so she has been a key inspiration to me. I mean, I still don't know how I came to the United States because she made it happen.
Wow.
So it has just been a God-driven phenomenon, which I am just happy that I am the tool that is being used to drive this process.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I'm really, I like you. Since we start working together, I discovered that you are reliable, you are serious young man, and I hope you will be even, probably president of Cameroon. I wish you all the best. Seriously. I found it to be very responsible and serious young man, and I wish you all the best. At the moment, what is the Youth Action Africa doing? What kind of project you are running at this current moment?
Well, we have, I would say, 4 different projects that we're working on. But for today, I just want to talk about one project, which is our key project, our flagship project. And I will tell you why I decided just to talk about this one particular project. So first of all, our key project, it is the Computer and Business Development Center. And what it seeks to do, it is providing computer literacy courses to community members. But that is not all. On this particular platform, we also provide entrepreneurship And we also provide microfinance for people that graduate from our program. And what this program has, it is very, very interesting. Why? Because we get people at three different levels for the computer literacy, wherein you have the basic, you have the intermediate, and then you have the advanced. So people come in at different levels, and they gain the skills that they need to get. But we don't only let them go after the computer literacy, because sometimes it is not what they really need to succeed or to get the next job. We offer professional training. We provide access to jobs. I have my other company, which is called Lobulo. It is a job search website for Cameroon.
Here in America?
Yeah, I have it here. Well, I created it here in America, but it seeks to advertise Cameroonian jobs only. It only focuses on Cameroon jobs. So
give me an example, Link.
It's for example, a monster.com where people go in for jobs, but this one is only for Cameroon jobs.
Yeah, so somebody has to be Cameroonian.
Well, no, you don't have to be Cameroonian, okay. But it only advertises job opportunities that are in Cameroon.
Okay. Yeah.
So it is here, so we have people that want to leave from here and go back home and work. They also have access to these jobs to apply. So,
it's excellent.
Yeah, so this is what we have attached to our platform in Cameroon. And we hope to do this for every country that it is involved in, because, I mean, the job search process, it is so broad nowadays. So we try to make it so that it is target specific for a particular population. So on that, after the computer literacy, the next thing that we move our participants into is entrepreneurship. And entrepreneurship, we have two different sections. You have the basic and the advanced. Well, the basic, it is more or less just learning how to start a business, learning the challenges of a business, and all those things. And then the other side is actually starting something, wherein we put people into teams. First of all, teaching them team building and team management, and then having them work on a particular project, or they could bring in their own projects and work on them. So we provide them a scaffolding platform wherein they could be able to start up their businesses. And you know it, in Africa, it is very, very easy to start a business. People start businesses with $25, with $50, and they succeed, because you know, you just need to have an idea, find out what people in your community do need, and then you could even start it right in front of your door here.
Yeah.
So it's very interesting, because for what we have been doing, people have been coming out with, you know, very simple but creative ideas, and ideas that have been very, very successful. So for those that create these business teams, we support them now with these microfinance loans, which helps them now, you know, get into the business arena. But that is not all. We don't let them go. We stick with them for at least 6 months and provide them the support that they do need. Why? Because sometimes people start businesses, but if you are not a business person or you don't have that business intellect, you don't foresee what could be coming ahead. Mm-hmm. And especially for a continent like Africa, which, you know, you would not say that most of the people are business savvy, you find out that a lot of people make mistakes, especially in businesses. Whenever I go back home, the last business that was the biggest business in Cameroon, when I go back home, I realize that business, they're out of business. Why? It's because these people don't, they think they know how to do business, but they end up not knowing how to do the business.
Yeah.
And it's just because they don't have that business infrastructure like the West does. So we secure people and provide them with a 6 months way that they get to, you know, be able to carry on their businesses, and then we monitor them for success. So that is why I wanted to just focus on this particular computer and business
Excellent.
Center.
We don't have too much time, but you also have a program called Volunteer. What is it? You know? This one is exciting for every. tell us about it.
Yeah.
We don't have too much time, but that would be
sure.
Our
no, no.
Last
I think
question.
You. I think. I'm
Before
glad
we
you,
leave,
you made that time. Volunteer. It's a very interesting concept that I came up with, and it hasn't been long that I just thought of the idea, and I thought, well, how do you connect donors to impact? Because there is always that disconnect that happens where people donate, but they don't know where it goes to, or people are waiting to receive something and they don't know who donates anything. Mm-hmm. So how do you bridge these people together without them actively being on the ground? And I thought Volunteer would be that key concept. And it is volunteer, as you see the term, it combines volunteering and tourism. So you have people that want to take, a tourist, they want to visit an area, but while visiting this area, they could end up volunteering in something, which even makes their trip worth, very interesting, because, you are connected with people on the ground, you go there, you see the ground, and you are able to interact with people on the ground. So what volunteer does is that we are able to discount your airfare when you're going, for example, right now it's only to Cameroon and in Ghana. So we could discount your airfare in a way that when you get to Cameroon or in Ghana, you volunteer at our facility, maybe teaching computer courses or entrepreneurship, or even donating a computer or a laptop to that center. So it's a very interesting concept, and it's something that we want to use to really promote the essence of this organization.
It's a very good interview, Roland. We don't have too much time. Definitely, we will invite you back. You have been watching the African Television Network of New England. Thank you for watching, and arrivederci.